Let's all go to the music hall, where the going is gay and bright. Let's all go to the music hall, where the sound of music fills the night. If you sit in the gallery, the circle or the pit, or whether you sit in a red back store, when your busy day is done and you want to have some fun, let's all go to the music hall.
Welcome to Westcliff High School for Boys Centenary Music Hall production. This is going to be a wonderful way for our community to join together to celebrate the end of our centenary year. I've had the opportunity to attend a number of rehearsals, and I can tell you that you're in for a real treat. These remarkable performances from our pupils will leave you feeling upbeat and banish the difficulties of the COVID-19 pandemic for at least a little while. The breadth of creativity on display is breathtaking. Centenary Music Hall was a fantastic choice of format by our director of drama, Mr. Jeffries. This takes us back to the 19th and early part of the 20th century, a time inhabited by the founders of Westcliff High School for Boys. This combination of history and celebration is the perfect way to mark the end of 2020. The format of Centenary Music Hall enables us to showcase the talents of all our pupils at the school, from year 7 through to the upper 6th. Indeed, it was wonderful to see the way our year 7s have thrown themselves into the cultural life of the school, despite the challenges of joining us during the COVID-19 pandemic. I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of the pupils involved in this production. As ever, I am in awe of the talent on display, and this production provides the perfect vehicle for demonstrating that talent, which is at times joyous, hugely creative, and even occasionally riotous. I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of the staff involved in the production, and although sadly I do not have time to list them all, I would particularly like to thank Mr. Derek, our inspirational director of music, and Mr. Jeffries, our highly creative and talented and indefatigable director of drama. Mr. Jeffries is also the author of our show as well as its director. And finally, I would like to thank all of our parents and friends and our wider community who join us in order to view this production. May I take this opportunity to wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year from all at Westcliff High School for Boys. So please sit back and enjoy the show.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present to you Centenary Music Hall, the Victorian style of entertainment that gave rise to the great Christmas panto. And to celebrate its links with panto, we're presenting it to you in the form of this year's Christmas pantomime, Dick Whittington, set in London Town.
Stands in Piccadilly Circus, Nelson stands in Trafalgar Square.
Big Ben stands by the River Thames and will as long as the Thames is there.
London is a strange, unchanging town, but take my word, whatever you've heard, London Bridge has no intention of
London is London, is anyone in doubt about it? London is London, it's easy to find out about it. London is springtime, Cockney champagne. London is summer, lots of rain, but who's complaining? London is lovely, there's no one changed his mind about it. Lovely and lively, yes, that's the thing I find about it. You can have Paris and Venice and Rome, but London.
London, is London, is London, is England, is home. Consider yourself at home. Consider yourself one of the family. We've taken to you so strong. It's clear we're going to get along. Consider yourself well in. Consider yourself a part of the furniture. There isn't a lot to spare. Who cares what ever we've got we share. If it's a chance to be, we should see some harder days. Empty larder days, why grouse? Always a chance to meet somebody to foot the bill when the drinks are on the house. Consider yourself our mate. We don't want to have no fuss. For after some consideration we can stay. Consider yourself one of us. Maybe it's because I'm a Londoner that I love London so. Maybe it's because I'm a Londoner that I think of her wherever I go. I get a funny feeling inside of me just walking up and down. Maybe it's because I'm a Londoner that I love London town.
Here we go.
Any time you're Lambeth way, any evening, any day, you'll find us all doing the Lambeth walk. Oi, every little Lambeth gal with a little Lambeth pound, you'll find them all doing the Lambeth walk. Oi, everything free and easy, do as you darn well pleasey. Why don't you make your way there, go there, stay there. Once you get down Lambeth way, any evening, any day, you'll find yourself doing the Lambeth, doing the Lambeth, doing the Lambeth walk. Oi!
What's that coming down the street?
It looks like the River Thames, but it's all brown and furry.
Look at those mad eyes, those sharp teeth, those long tails. It's an army of rats!
Yes, here I am. I'm the king of the rats, and I'm nastier than taking your year six sats. Even Mr. Tresidder isn't hairier, and even Mr. Williams isn't scarier. And with my long-tailed ratty force, I'll make London browner than HP sauce. And now I know you're hoping that all of London's rats have been defeated by London's cats, and it's true that ending up in a cat's belly is even scarier than Mr. Skelly. But I have locked up all those nasty mugs, and now they're guarded by my own pet dogs. So no one can thwart my evil plots, for plans I have lots and lots to rule all London now and forever. Admit it now, am I not clever? More evil than Blair or Maggie Thatcher, but where I ask, is your town's rat catcher? He's gone, I'm afraid, and I'll tell you the story. Although beware, it's a little bit gory. Not long ago in Westminster, there lived a rat catcher's daughter, but she didn't quite live in Westminster. She lived t'other side of the water. Her father caught rats and she sold sprats all around and about that quarter. And the gentlefolk all took off their hats to the pretty little rat catcher's daughter. Doodle dee, doodle dum, di dum doodle da. Now rich and poor, both far and near, in
matrimony, sorta. But at friends and foes, she turned up her nose to the pretty little rat catcher's daughter. For there was a man, sold lily white sand in Cupid's net, had caught her. And writes over head and heels in love when the pretty little rat catcher's daughter. Doodle dee, doodle dum, die dum doodle da. When Lily White Sand he heard the news, he cried down in laughter. For me in love I'll constant prove, and blow me if I live long after. So he cut his throat with a pane of glass, and he stabbed his Don Quixote. And that was the end for Lily White Sand, Donkey and the Rat Catcher's daughter. Doodle dee, doodle dum, die dum doodle dum. Ha ha ha.
And there we have it, the villainous King Rat. Rather reminiscent of a few teachers I had over the 7 happy years I spent here at Westcliff High School for Boys. Historically, Westcliff was a Victorian seaside resort, and we celebrate that now with the Year 7s.
To this rule, in fact, if I had my way, I'd reside by the side of the silvery sea. But when you're just a common or garden working lad like me, a chance to see the sea is quite a novelty. I save up all the money I can while winter's grim and grey, then off I run to have some fun where the balmy breezes play.
Oh, I do like to be beside the sea.
After me.
His trunk was waving in the air and spouting jets of steam, and he was out to eat me up, but still I didn't scream.
Or let him see that I was scared, a better thought I had.
I just escaped from where I was,
and crawled in bed with Dad.
A giant who was horrible to see. He had 3 heads and 20 arms, and he came chasing after me.
And red hot fire came from his mouth, and every hand was red. And he declared he'd grind my bones and make them into bread.
I was just too smart for him, I fooled him right bad.
Before his hands could collar me,
I crawled in bed with Dad.
I've just had a letter to say I'm engaged to appear in a pantomime. The part I'm to play is the principal boy, so I'm in for a beautiful time. The panto's Dick Whittington, I'm Dirty Dick, the fellow who once wrote to York. The manager says I must get a good song, about which the public will talk. I've commissioned some authors to write me a song, a very fine chorus they've sent me along. She sells seashells on the seashore, the shells she sells are seashells, I'm sure. For if she sells seashells on the seashore, then I'm sure she sells seashore shells.
That comes pestering me at night.
Once I was chased by 40 ghosts, all shimmering and white.
And I just raced them round the room and let them think maybe I'd have to stop and rest a while when they could capture me.
They leapt onto my bed, oh gee, were they mad, to find that I had slipped away and crawled in bed with Dad.
The seashells she sells are a terrible sell, and the song is a sell or so. The authors both say it will go very big, but I fear I am all that will go. I've suffered from lockjaw and stickjaw as well, and trying this chorus to sing, it's making me list, but I say to myself, the song shall to go in the swing. I'm dreaming of seashells when I am in bed. I only wish she would sell matches instead. She sells seashells on the seashore. The shells she sells are seashells, I'm sure. For if she sells seashells on the seashore, then I'm sure she sells seashore shells.
No giants, ghosts or elephants had dared to call in there, cause if they did, he'd beat them up and chase them to the lair.
They just hang around children's rooms and snap and snarl and bite, and laugh if they can make them yell for help with all their might.
But I don't ever shout out loud, I'm not that sort of lad. I just slip outside the covers and I crawl in bed with Dad.
She sells seashells on the seashore. The shells she sells are seashells, I'm sure.
At Cambridge University, I've spent time as president of the Medics Review Society, a comedy sketch troupe. Many of the finest comedians of today trace their roots back to comic greats of music hall, the likes of Sid Field and Arthur Askey. Our Year 10s pay tributes to these greats in the next sketch.
Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you are having a wonderful evening.
We have many more wonderful music hall songs to come, like the old classic, I Can't Get Over a Girl Like You.
Have to make the tea yourself.
But before we all get carried away, I'd like to tell you something about myself. I was born at a very young age.
I cried like a baby.
I was a surprise to my parents when they found me on the doorstep. They were expecting a bottle of milk.
When I was younger, I used to sing songs at home in front of a roaring fireplace. But my dad got cross when I did, because we never had one.
That's nothing. When I was 4 years old, my father caught me smoking and smacked my brother for it. Mind you, that was fair. It was my brother who set me on fire.
Brothers, eh? My brother, he's always been a big part of our family. Last week, I found him crying. I said, "What's wrong?" He said, "Homesick." I said, "But this is your home." He said, "Oh no, I'm sick of it."
Now, there was always drama in my family. So, to cheer us all up, my parents got a puppy for my brother. I think it was a good swap.
Drama. You should see my family. My mum's always on a diet. Last year, she drank nothing but 10 pints of water a day. She lost 8 pounds and gained 50 gallons.
Come to think of it, our childhood days were perfect. We went to the seaside and my dad knocked on the hotel window. The owner popped his head out and said, "What do you want?" My dad said, "No, we want to stay here." The owner said, "Stay there then," and shut the window.
My favourite part about going to the seaside was the ice cream. I remember going up to the ice cream van and asking the lady for a cornet. She'd say, "Hundreds and thousands?" I go, "No, just one will do."
Oh, and playing on the beach. One holiday, we buried my brother in sand. One day, we're gonna dig him back up.
Now, what's the worst thing about going on holiday?
Having to come back.
I remember my first day at school. The teacher came in and said, all you on the left are fools and all you on the right are idiots. Then he came in on the second day and he said it again. All you on the left are fools and all you on the right are idiots. When he came in on the third day, he said it again. I put my hand up and said, wait a minute, sir. I'm no fool. He said, well, go sit over there with the idiots then.
It's the same old tale of a love-struck woman every time, every time. It's the same old trouble of a lad that wants to be married very bad. It's the same old heart that's longing for its lady every time. Yes, every time, but not the same gal, not the same gal. She is my lily, my lily, my lily gal. She goes every sundown, yes, every sundown, calling in the cattle up the mountain. I go, case she wants me, yes, case she wants me, help her do the calling and the counting. She plays her music to call the lone lambs that roam above, but I'm the black sheep and I'm waiting for the signal of my little lady love. She's my baby love, she's my dove, my baby love. She's no gal for sitting down to dream, she's the only queen Laguna knows. I know she likes me, I know she likes me, because she says so. She is my lily of Laguna, she is my lily and my rose.
My old man said, follow the van, don't dilly-dally on the way. Off went the cart with the home packed in it. I walk behind with my old cob linnet, but I dillied and dallied, dallied and dillied. Lost the van and don't know where to roam. I stopped on the way to have an old half quarter, and I can't find my way home.
There's a one-eyed yellow idol to the north of Kathmandu. There's a little marble cross below the town. There's a broken-hearted woman tends the grave of Mad Karoo, and the yellow god forever gazes down. He was known as Mad Karoo by the subs at Kathmandu. He was hotter than he felt inclined to tell. But for all his foolish pranks, he was worshipped in the ranks, and the colonel's daughter smiled on him as well. He had loved her all along with a passion of the strong. The fact that she loved him was plain to all. She was nearly 21, and 21, and arrangements had begun to celebrate her birthday with a ball. He wrote to ask what present she would like from Mad Karoo. They met next day as he dismissed a squad. And jestingly, she told him that nothing else would do but the little green eye of the god. On the night before the dance, Mad Karoo seemed in a trance, and they chaffed him as they puffed at their cigars. But for once, he failed to smile and sat alone a while, and went out into the night beneath the stars. He returned before the dawn with his shirt and tunic torn and a gash across his temple, dripping red. He was patched up right away and slept throughout the day, and the colonel's daughter watched beside his bed. He woke at last and asked if they could send his tunic through. She brought it, and he thanked her with a nod. He bade her search the pocket, saying, "That's from Mad Carew." And she found the eye of the little yellow god. She upbraided poor Carew in the way that women do, though both her eyes were strangely hot and wet. But she wouldn't take the stone, and Mad Carew was left alone with the jewel he chanced his life to get. When the bull was at its height on that still and tropic night, she thought of him and hurried to his room. As she crossed the barrack square, she could hear the dreamy air of a waltz tune softly stealing through the gloom. His door was open wide with silver moonlight shining through. The place was wet and slippery where she trod. An ugly knife was buried deep in the heart of Mad Carew. 'Twas the vengeance of the little yellow god. There's a one-eyed yellow idol to the north of Kathmandu. There's a little marble cross below the town. There's a broken-hearted woman tends the grave of Mad Carew, and the yellow god forever gazes down.
Let's get back to Dick Whittington. You'll remember that King Rat and his army of rats are sweeping across London. Who could stop them? It's a particular problem for Sarah, the royal cook, because the rats are nibbling at the king's cheese. Let's see how she gets on.
Hello, boys and girls. My name's Sarah the Cook, but you can call me the Lean, Mean Cooking Machine. Only problem is my kitchen's currently infested with rats. And boys and girls, that's making me a little bit sad. But one thing that always gets me happy is singing. Oh, I remember this one song. I used it when I first met my husband. Ah, yes. Marbella 2016. Take it away, maestro.
I'm a young girl and I've just come over from the country where they do things big. And amongst the boys, I've got myself a lover. And since I've got a lover, well, I don't give a fig. The boy I love is up in the gallery. Boy I love is looking down at me. There he is, can't you see? Waving his handkerchief as merry as a robin that sings on the tree. Boy I love, why they say he's a cobbler, but he's not a cobbler, allow me to state. For Johnny is a tradesman and he works in the borough, while they sole and heal them while you wait. The boy I love is up in the gallery, boy I love is waving down at me. There he is, can't you see? Waving his handkerchief as merry as a robin that sings on the tree. Now, if I were a duchess and I had a lot of money, I'd give it to the boy who's going to marry me. But I haven't got a penny, so we'll live on love and kisses, and we'll be as happy as the birds on the tree. The boy I love is up in the gallery. Boy I love is waving down at me. There he is, can't you see? Waving his handkerchief, merry as a robin that sings on the tree. Oh, thank you, boys and girls. I feel a lot happier now. Although, could you help me out with something? Have you seen my two kids, Idle Jack and Idle Jill? Oh, they are the laziest kids I know. Why? He's so lazy that if he had a third hand, he'd need a third pocket to put it in. And she's so lazy that she sticks her nose out the window and lets the wind blow it. Where are they? Jack? Jill? Have you seen them? Oh, they must be down here somewhere. I can smell them. Jack? Jill?
Hello, boys and girls. Oh. Hello, Mum. What are you yelling for?
Oh, there you are. Now, come help me. I need to clean out this kitchen. Well, what's the point of even asking? You two are the laziest kids I know.
That's not our fault. We got it from our father.
Oh, you barely knew your father. Well, come to think of it, neither did I. Although I do remember what he said the first time he met me. He said, "Fair lady."
Was he a romantic?
No, he was a bus conductor.
You're wrong. Our father was a sea dog. That's why I never came home.
Your father was a dirty dog. That's why he never came home.
Look, I'll make it up to you. You can have a lick of my lollipop.
Oh, that's very nice. Ooh, it's a very nice lollipop.
You can spit in all different colours.
Oh, spitting is a dirty habit. This lollipop is very tasty, though.
It really is a good one. I was lucky to get it.
Oh, where'd you get it from?
My dog found it in the bin.
Oh, that's typical of you. One day you two are going to drive me out of my mind.
We won't have far to go, will you?
Ah, no wonder I'm so old and grey. Having to raise two kids like you.
That's true. You're so old. On your last birthday, the candles cost more than the cake.
Ah, mind you, I get a lot of male attention at 72. And it's convenient because I only live at 68.
Oh, to be old and carefree.
Oh, it wasn't always like that. When I was young, I was second to none, well-groomed and handsome.
Now look at you, second and none too well and gruesome.
Ah, I'm still beautiful, though. I've got the complexion of a schoolgirl at 16.
Well, give it back to her. You're wrinkling it.
When I was young, I was all pink and dimples.
And now you're all drinking pimples.
You can laugh, but when I was young, I was the talk of the town.
You still are.
Well, I guess that's right. My, I was graceful. I could dance like that Rudolph near enough.
It's pronounced Nureyev.
Well, it's near enough. Oh, you've made me sad now, thinking about how old I am. Oh, I know. I'll go shopping.
That's a good idea.
Yes, whenever I'm down in the dumps, I always get myself a new hat.
That's where you get them.
Yeah, new hat's just what I need, because I've had a trying day today.
Have you?
Yeah. The butcher tried, the baker tried, and the milkman tried. And just this morning, I had my car stolen.
Oh, that's terrible. Did you see who did it?
No, but I got the registration number. Anyway, have you done your maths homework? I don't want you to upset the teacher.
Don't worry. I'm the teacher's pet. Keeps me in a cage at the back of the class.
Oh, well, come on then, let me help you. I've got I've got two chocolate bars. Now, if I put two in your hat and then take one away, how many you got?
Two.
Oh, you're hopeless. Right, give me the chocolate back.
I knew that bit was too good to be true.
I've got two chocolate bars. I put two in your hat and take one away. How many have you got?
Two.
How could that possibly be true?
Because I've got another one here.
Oh, you're too smart for your own good sometimes. One day you'll go far, and I hope you stay there. And who are you?
Oi, I'm Dick Whittington, and I've come from Gloucestershire to seek my fortune. What are you doing in that dress, all worn out and tatty?
Oi, this dress ain't worn out and tatty.
I wasn't referring to the dress.
Comments like that, the only fortune you'll be getting is a thick ear.
Do forgive me. I'm new in old London town.
Oh, well, you're the only thing that is. Everything else in London is old. These jokes for a start. So, what have you got to offer?
Hard work and graft.
And you promise to work hard?
We promise.
And you know what happens to little boys who don't keep their promises?
No. What?
They become members of Parliament.
I've heard all you do in London town is sing songs and drink beer.
Well, there's lots of lovely little songs to sing about London. Oh, I remember once I was on holiday in the countryside, in a pub, and I started singing, "Maybe it's because I'm a Londoner that I love London so." And one of the men in the bar started crying.
Was he a Londoner?
No, he was a singing teacher. Oh, is that your cat?
Yes.
Hmm. I know a joke about cats.
Oh, go on then.
What do you get if you cross a leopard with a watchdog?
Ooh, I don't know. What do you get if you cross a leopard with a watchdog?
Terrified postman.
And why should you never sneak out of the house with a leopard?
Oh, I don't know. Why should you never sneak out of the house with a leopard?
Because a leopard's always spotted.
Oh.
And what type of car does a cat drive?
Ooh, I don't know. What type of car does a cat drive?
A Ferrari.
Oh. And what do you get if you cross a tiger with a snowman?
I don't know. What do you get if you cross a tiger with a snowman?
Frostbite.
Oh.
And Where do cats go on holiday?
I know this one. The Canary Islands. Anyway, we don't want cats around here. All they do is claw on the sofa and whittle on the carpet.
Rats.
It's true, I've seen them do it.
No, rats. Rat catching cats catch rats.
Oh, it's easy for you to say, but it's worth a try. What brings rats out?
Smell of stinky cheese.
Oh, take your socks off then.
That won't work. I only put them on last week.
Oh, you know what? We'll use mine. I need a volunteer with no sense of smell.
You need a volunteer with no sense at all.
Then you'll be perfect for it. Come here.
Oh, that smells disgusting.
What?
Why don't you cover up the smell with toilet water?
Well, I tried that, but the seat fell on me head. Yoo-hoo! Ratty!
Who calls me here so old and smelly with dyed pink hair and a great fat belly? Wrinkles, false teeth and a great big bum. You're starting to remind me of my old mum. Quake in fear and knock your knees. Why have you summoned me with the smell of cheese?
Don't think you're the only one who can talk in rhyming. I'll do it too, with comic timing.
We're gonna save old London town by bringing you in and taking you down.
Taking me down? You haven't got a hope. I'm slippier than slipping on a slippy bar of soap. Evil, powerful, villainous, mad. No one can stop me from being bad. And that's a fact. I won't be redacting. I'm terribly bad.
Yeah, bad at acting.
Only one thing can stop me, more's the pity, and that's the appearance of a great big kitty.
Then you're out of luck, you big brown mincer. Get ready to be trapped in a claw-like pincer. With help of any cat that I've befriended, your days in London town are ended.
Curse you all, but I can't bear cats. I'll retrieve my host of rats before you celebrate, party and laugh. Hear this, I'll be back again in the second half.
Well, I got rid of him. Now, I think it's lunchtime. How about some ratatouille? Okay, well, maybe just some beans on toast then.
Celebrating its centenary this year, Westcliff was founded in 1920 in the aftermath of the First World War. Many of the tunes of the First World War were taken from Music Hall. Year 9 will remind us of those timeless tunes in this next medley.
Left, 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 right, left. Colonel for Zachary Butterworth, toast!
Colonel for Zachary Butterworth, toast!
Bought an old castle complete with a ghost!
Bought an old castle complete with a ghost!
But someone or other forgot to declare to Colonel for Zach that the spectre was there!
On the very first evening while waiting to dine,
on the very first evening while waiting to dine,
the Colonel was taking a fine sherry wine.
The Colonel was taking a fine sherry wine!
When the ghost with a furious flash and a flare shot out of the chimney and shivered, beware!
Colonel for Zachary put down his glass.
Colonel for Zachary put down his glass.
And said, my dear fellow, that's really first class.
And said, my dear fellow, that's really first class.
I just can't conceive how you do it at all. I imagine you're going to a fancy dress ball.
At this the dread ghost made a withering cry, said the Colonel, his monocle firm in his eye. Now just how you do it, I really can't think. Do sit down and tell me and please have a drink.
The ghost, in his phosphorus cloak, gave a roar. He floated between ceiling and floor. He walked through a wall and returned through a pane. And he backed up the chimney and came down again.
Said the Colonel with laughter, I'm feeling quite weak, as trickles of merriment ran down his cheek. My housewarming party, I hope you won't spurn. You must say you'll come and you'll give us a turn.
At this, the poor spectre, quite out of his wits, proceeded to shake himself, almost to bits. He rattled his chains, and he clattered his bones, and he filled the whole castle with mumbles and moans.
But Colonel for Zachary, just as before, was simply delighted and called out,
Encore!
At which the ghost vanished, his efforts in vain, and never was seen at the castle again.
Oh dear, what a pity, said Colonel for Zach. I don't know his name, so I can't call him back. And with a smile that was hard to define, Colonel for Zachary went in to dine.
Roll out the barrel, we'll have a barrel of fun. Roll out the barrel, we've got the blues on the run. Sing, boom, ta-ra-roll. ring out a song of good cheer. Now's the time to roll the barrel, for the gang's all here. Now's the time to roll the barrel, for the gang's all here. Pack up your troubles in your old kit bag and smile, smile, smile. While you've a lucifer to light your fag, smile boys, that's the style. Use of worrying, it never was worthwhile. So pack up your troubles in your old kit bag and smile, smile, smile. It's a long way to Tipperary, it's a long way to go. It's a long way to Tipperary, to the sweetest girl I know. In your old bag, it's a long way to go. It's a long way to light your bag to the sweetest, that's the stone. Goodbye, Piccadilly. Farewell, Leicester Square. It's a long, long way to Tipperary, but my heart lies there.
Now let's get back to our main performance of Dick Whittington. Dick's cat has chased out the villainous King Rat from town, and now Dick is the talk of London town. Every girl will be hoping to catch his eye at the upcoming Corporation Ball. Let's see how two of them are trying to make themselves look beautiful. Two sisters, currently not the prettiest of sights.
How did you sleep last night, Fortitudinal dear?
How do you think? With my eyes closed. That's when you weren't snoring.
Do you have to wake up grumpy every morning?
I don't. Snow White wakes up grumpy every morning.
Why are you in such a bad mood?
Because I need my beauty sleep.
Does sleep make you beautiful?
Yes, it does.
Well, you must have been lying awake a lot then. Let's ring for breakfast. What shall we have?
Well, eggs get you cracking.
And prunes get you going.
You can't beat eggs.
You're so ignorant. Of course you can. You can whip them too. All of that punishment, and sooner or later, they'll crack.
Well, I don't know. Some of them are hard-boiled characters.
I've just remembered. Tonight is the night of the Corporation Ball!
Of course it is. Tonight, Dick Whittington will sweep me off my feet.
Well, he'll need a dumper truck to do it.
How dare you? Last year, I was the belle of the ball.
Well, since then, you've lost your clangor. Anyway, don't remind me about last year's ball.
Why? What happened?
When I arrived, there was a man at the door. He asked to see my ticket.
And what did you say?
I said that my face was the ticket.
And what did he say?
That he had orders to punch every ticket.
Well, the year before was even worse. All that drama with the prince and Cinderella. And I couldn't get my foot in the crystal slipper.
And you couldn't get your foot in the crystal palace.
But since then, I've gone on a diet. All I eat now is olive oil, sunflower oil, and vegetable oil.
Have you lost weight?
No, but I don't squeak anymore.
Well, the last diet I went on, I ate nothing but baked beans.
I remember. I wrote a poem about it.
What poem?
My sister's eating just baked beans, enough to fill a cart.
A cart?
Yes, a cart.
What's the poem about?
It's about the impact of eating a lot of baked beans.
Go on then.
My sister's eating just baked beans, enough to fill a cart. And when all you eat is just baked beans, there's no room for apple tart.
Ooh, you've got away with words.
And this year, I will go to the Corporation Ball and meet the man of my dreams.
And he will meet the girl of his nightmares.
But men say I have everything they want.
Well, that's true. Muscles, a moustache and a hairy chest.
I've got an hourglass figure.
Well, all the sand has gone to the bottom.
It's been so long since I've had a boyfriend. I had to let the last one go. He kept spilling hot chocolate all over my pink frilly nightdress. Well, mind you, he should never have been wearing it.
The last boyfriend I had took me to a French restaurant.
Well, the last time I went to a restaurant, I ordered everything off the menu in fluent French. All my friends were astonished.
Why were they astonished?
It was a Chinese restaurant.
Well, this one definitely was a French restaurant. I asked for La Plume de la Rochelle, and they said you can't have that. It's the band. So they offered me an ox tongue salad.
The cheeky thing.
No, it's maybe the tongue of an ox.
Oh, so what did you say?
I said I never eat anything from the mouth of an animal.
So what did you have?
An egg.
Well, I want a man who will pick me up, whirl me around and drain me dry.
You don't want a man, you want a spin dryer. Anyway, what happened to that last one you're going to marry?
Oh, don't remind me about him.
Why? What happened?
I'll tell you. I'm in a nice bit of trouble, I confess. Somebody with me has had a game.
Tell me more.
I should by now be a proud and happy bride, but I've still got to keep my single name. I was proposed to by Obadiah Binks.
Lovely name.
In a very gentlemanly way. Lent him all my money so that he could buy a home, and punctually at 12 o'clock today. I'll tell you. There was I, waiting at the church, waiting at the church, waiting at the church, when I found he'd left me in the lurch. Lo, how it did upset me. All at once, he sent me round a note.
A note?
Here's the very note.
What's it say?
This is what he wrote. Can't get away to marry you today. My wife won't let me. What sort of dress shall I wear to the corporation ball?
Well, you normally wear a bingo dress.
A bingo dress?
Yes, a bingo dress.
What's a bingo dress?
Eyes down, look in.
Who's that?
I ordered a man to make up for the corporation ball. Here he is now.
I am Signore Fassione. I have come from Milan to make you look beautiful. Who is Fidelia Westcliffe?
I am Fidelia Westcliffe, and this is my sister Fortitudine.
Westcliffe girls, that's us.
I've heard you are 100 years old.
Oi, none of your cheek. Get on with it.
You've booked a two-hour sessione. That should be enough for the estimate.
Of course it will be. My face will become a work of art.
Modern art.
I have the face of a film star.
From a horror movie?
Well, if I had a face like yours, I'd put it on a wall and throw a brick at it.
And if I had a face like yours, I'd put it on a brick and throw a wall at it.
Your head's so big you can't even get a headache to fit you.
Well, everyone has the right to be ugly, but you abuse the privilege.
Ladies, let us not fight. Let us concentrate on bringing out your beauty. That's going to take all our time and effort. Let us begin.
Thank you.
The story of Dick Whittington was a tale of London's history as much as it was a tale of its early mayor. For this reason, every performance always includes a scene at sea, celebrating London's history as a trading port. And our performance is no exception, as pirates have seized the king's ship, and Dick Whittington and Sarah the cook are on their way to seize it back. Let's see how they get on.
Better far to live or die, under the great black flag I fly, than play a sanctimonious part, with a pirate head and a pirate heart. Away from the cheating world go you, where pirates all are well to do, but I'll be true to the song I sing, and live and die a pirate king. For I'm the Pirate King. And it is a glorious thing to be the Pirate King. For I am the Pirate King.
You are the Pirate King.
And it is a glorious thing to be the Pirate King.
It is, hurrah for the Pirate King.
Hurrah for the Pirate King. When I sally forth to seek my prey, I help myself in a royal way. I sink a few more ships, it's true, than a well-bred monarch ought to do. But any a king on his first-class throne, if he wants to call his crown his own, must manage somehow to get through more dirty work than ever I do. For I am the Pirate King. And it is a glorious thing to be the Pirate King. For I am the Pirate King.
You are, hurrah, the Pirate King.
And it is a glorious thing to be the Pirate King.
It is, hurrah, the Pirate King. Hurrah, the Pirate King.
Right, it's time to put you through your paces. Crew, fall in.
Aye, aye, Captain.
What are you doing?
You said fall in.
No, fall in over there.
Aye, aye, Captain.
No, no, no. When I say fall in, I mean get in line.
Oh, sorry.
Now, who can tell me what the front of the ship is called? Bow. What are you doing? Bow. Bow. No, the front of the ship is called the bow.
Oh, sorry.
Just the same way that the back of the ship is called the stern. What is it called?
The back of the ship.
Stern.
The back of the ship!
Stern!
We can't do it any sterner, Captain.
Now, imagine you are at the helm of the ship.
Yes.
In uncharted territory.
Yes.
What is on your right?
The east, Captain.
And what is on your left?
The west, Captain.
And what is on your back?
Me vest, Captain.
I give up. Crew, get your mops. From the right number, I shall start. One.
Two. Three. Four.
One.
No, I'm one. And again. One.
Two. Three. Four.
One.
No, I'm one. I am one.
We can see that.
For goodness sake. Drill time. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One. That's what I want. Now do it.
One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One. That's what he wants, now do it.
No, no, no. The mops go here.
Pardon?
Pick up the mops, they go here. Here. Oh, I'm getting really sick of you.
I'm seizing a ship for king and country.
And I'm here for the booze.
Oh, crew, drop the mops, on guard.
No!
Don't you get my ship!
That's
it! Take mine! I'm the Pirate King! No!
Look over there!
What a relief. Much to our surprise, they saved the day again. Music Hall was always an opportunity to present fun and traditional stories through lively sketches. Now, years 7 and 9 will present two traditional stories, Three Little Pigs and Jack and the Beanstalk, with a twist.
The animal I really dig, above all others, is the pig. Pigs are noble, pigs are clever, pigs are courteous. However,
now and then, to break this rule, one meets a pig who is a fool. What, for example, would you say if strolling through the woods one day, right there in front of you, you saw a pig who'd built his house of straw? The wolf who saw it licked his lips and said,
"That pig has had his chips. Little pig, let me come in."
"No, no, no, but here's my chin, chin, chin."
"Then I'll huff and I'll puff. And I'll blow your house in!"
The little pig began to pray, but Wolfie blew his house away. He shouted,
"Bacon, pork and ham! Oh, what a lucky wolf I am!"
And though he ate the pig quite fast, he carefully kept the tail till last.
The wolf wandered on, a trifle bloated. Surprise, surprise! For soon he noticed another little house for pigs, and this one was built of twigs.
Little pig, let me come in."
"No, no, no, by the hairs of my chinny, chin, chin."
"Then I'll huff and I'll puff. It'll blow your house in!"
The wolf said,
"Okay, here we go."
He then began to blow and blow. The little pig began to squeal and cried,
"Oh, wolf, you've had one meal. Why can't we talk and make a deal?"
The wolf replied,
"Not on your Nelly."
And soon the pig was in his belly.
"And two juicy little pigs,"
Wolf cried.
"Yet still, I'm not quite satisfied. I know full well my tummy's bulging, but oh, how I adore indulging."
So creeping quietly as a mouse, the wolf approached another house, a house which also had inside a little piggy trying to hide. But this one, piggy number 3, was bright and brainy as could be. No straw for him, no twigs or sticks. This pig had built his house of bricks.
"You'll not get me,"
the piggy cried.
"I'll blow it down,"
the wolf replied.
"You'll need,"
pig said,
"a lot of puff, and I don't think you've got enough."
The wolf huffed and puffed and blew and blew. The house stayed up as good as new.
"If I can't blow it down,"
Wolf said,
"I'll have to blow it up instead. I'll come back at the dead of night and blow it up with dynamite."
"You brute," Pig said. "I might have known." And picking up the telephone, he dialed as quickly as he could the number of Red Riding Hood.
"Hello,"
she said.
"Who's speaking? Who? Oh, hello, Piggy. How do you do?" "Help me, Miss Hood. Help me, please. Do you think you could?" "I'll try, of course,"
Miss Hood replied.
"What's on your mind?" "A wolf," Pig cried. "I know you've dealt with wolves before, and now I've got one at my door." "My darling pig," she said. "My sweet. That's something really up my street. I've just begun to wash my hair, but when it's dry, I'll be right there."
So, a short while later, through the woods came striding brave Miss Riding Hood. The wolf stood there, his eyes ablaze and yellowish like mayonnaise. His teeth were sharp, his gums were raw, and spit was dripping from his jaw. The maiden's eyelid barely flickers. She draws a pistol from her knickers. She hits poor Wolfie's vital spot and kills him with a single shot. Pig, peeping through the window, stood and yelled,
"Well done, Miss Hood. Ah, piglet, you must never trust young ladies from the upper crust. For now," one notes, "Miss Hood not only has a wolfskin coat, but when she goes from place to place, she carries a pigskin travelling case."
The end.
Jack and the Beanstalk.
Jack's mother said,
"We're stony broke. Go out and find some wealthy bloke who'll buy our cow.
Ooh.
Just say she's sound and worth at least £100, but don't you dare to let him know that she's as old as Billy-O."
Jack led the old brown cow away and came back later in the day and said,
"Oh, Mumsy dear, guess what? Your clever little boy has got, I really don't know how, a super trading for our cow." "You little creep, I bet you sold her much too cheap."
When Jack produced one lousy bean, his startled mother, turning green, leaped high up in the air and cried,
"I'm absolutely stupefied! You crazy boy, do you really mean you sold our daisy for a bean?"
She snatched the bean, she yelled,
"You chump!"
and flung it on the rubbish dump. Then, summoning up all her power, she beat the boy for half an hour, using, and nothing could be meaner, the handle of a vacuum cleaner.
At 10 p.m. or thereabout, the little bean began to sprout. By morning, it had grown so tall, you couldn't see the top at all.
Young Jack cried,
"Mum, admit it now, it's better than a rotten cow."
The mother said,
"You lunatic, where are the beans that I can pick? There's not one bean, it's bare as bare." "Look up, no, look up there, look very high and you'll behold, each single leaf is solid gold." By gollikins, the boy was right. Now, glistening in the morning light, the mother actually perceives a lovely mass of golden leaves. She yells out loud,
"My sated souls! I'll sell the mini, buy a rolls, don't stand at gape, you little clot, get up there quick and grab the lot." Jack was nimble, Jack was keen, he scrambled up the mighty bean. Up he went, without a stop, but just as he was near the top, a ghastly, frightening thing occurred. Not far above his head he heard a big, deep voice, a rumbling thing that made the very heavens ring. It shouted loud,
"Fee-fi-fo-fum, I smell the blood of an Englishman!"
Jack was frightened, Jack was quick, and down he climbed in half a tick.
"Oh, Mum,"
he gasped,
"believe you me, there's something nasty up our tree. I saw it, Mum, my gizzard froze, a giant with a clever nose."
"Clever nose?"
his mother hissed.
"You must be going round the twist."
"Smelled me out, I swear it, Mum, he said he smelled an Englishman."
The mother said,
"And well he might have told you every single night to take a bath because you smell. But would you do it? Would you hell? You even made your mother shrink because of your unholy stink."
Young Jack cried,
"Well, if you're so clean, why didn't you climb the crazy bean?"
The mother said,
"By gad, I will. There's life within the old dog still."
She hitched her skirts above her knee and disappeared right up the tree. Now, would the giant smell his mum? Jack listened for the fee-fo-fum. He gazed aloft. He wondered when the dreaded words would come.
And then, from somewhere high above the ground, there came a frightful crunching sound. He heard the giant mutter twice,
"My gosh, that tasted very nice, although..."
And this in grumpy tones,
"I wish there weren't so many bones."
"By Christopher,"
Jack cried,
"by gum, the giant is not my mum. He smelled her out. She's in his belly. I had a hunch that she was smelly."
Jack stood there gazing longingly upon the huge and golden tree. He murmured softly,
"Golly gosh, I guess I'll have to take a wash if I'm going to climb this tree without the giant smelling me. In fact, a bath's my only hope."
He rushed indoors and grabbed the soap.
He scrubbed his body everywhere. He even washed and rinsed his hair. He did his teeth, he blew his nose, and came out smelling like a rose. Once more, Jack climbed the mighty bean. The giant sat there, gross, obscene, muttering through his vicious teeth, while Jack sat tensely just beneath,
muttering loud,
"Fee-fi-fo-fum. Right now, I can't smell anyone."
Jack waited till the giant slept, then out along the boughs he crept and gathered so much gold, I swear, he was an instant millionaire.
"A bath," he said, "does seem to pay. I'm going to have one every day."
The end.
Westcliff continues to produce ambitious and varied pieces of drama, and we're proud of the talent and ability of the students that makes that possible. Two of our finest performers, the Seal Brothers, have themselves adapted and choreographed the following sketches for us to enjoy.
Thank you.
stop at the best hotels, but we prefer the country far away from the city smells. We're a couple of sports, the pride of the tennis courts. In June, July, and August, we look cute when we're dressed in shorts. The Vanderbilts have asked us up for tea.
We don't know how to get there, no siree,
no siree. We would drive up the avenue, but we haven't got the price. We would skate up the avenue, but there isn't any ice. We would ride on a bicycle, but we haven't got a bike. So we'll walk up the avenue, yes, we'll walk up the avenue. And to walk up the avenue's what we like. Bankers are we, with plenty of currency. We open up the safe, but we forgot where we put the key. We're the favorite lads of girls in the picture ads. We'd like to tell you who we kissed last night, but we can't be cats. Waiting at the club.
But how are we to get there? That's the rub.
That's the rub. We would sail up the avenue, but we haven't got a yacht. We would drive up the avenue, but the horse we had was shot. We would ride on the trolley car, but we haven't got the fare. So we'll walk up the avenue, yes, we'll walk up the avenue, yes, we'll walk up the avenue till we're there.
Thank you.
This evening's performance has almost come to an end, and we hope you enjoyed the show. On behalf of the cast, I'd like to thank everyone involved in putting this show together, in particular the headmaster, for his continued support of music and drama at the school. And now, we hope you enjoy this cheerful rendition of If I Were Not Upon This Stage, and good night.
If I were not upon this stage, someone else I'd like to be. If I were not upon this stage, a policeman I'd be. Happy all day long, and this would be my song. Evening all, stop right there, you must move along. Evening all, stop right there, you must move along. Evening all, stop right there, you must move along. Evening all, stop right there, you must move along.
If I were not upon this stage, someone else I'd like to be. If I were not upon this stage, a nurse I would be. Happy all day long, and this would be my song. Here's your tablets, here's your tea, take a deep breath in. Here's your tablets, here's your tea, take a deep breath in. Here's your tablets, here's your tea, take a deep breath in. Here's your tablets, here's your tea, take a deep breath in.
If I were not upon this stage, someone else I'd like to be. If I were not upon this stage, ballerina I would be. Happy all day long, and this would be my song. Demi-plié, touch your toes, turn yourself around. Demi-plié, touch your toes, turn yourself around.
Demi-plié, touch your toes, turn yourself around.
Demi-plié, touch your toes, turn yourself around.
Demi-plié, touch your toes, turn yourself around.
Demi-plié, touch your toes, turn yourself around.
If I were not upon this stage, someone else I'd like to be. If I were not upon the stage, a caveman I'd be. Happy all day long, and this would be my song. Move that bowler, grab that bear, terrorize the lions. Move that bowler, grab that bear, terrorize the lions.
Move that bowler, grab that bear, terrorize the lions. Turn yourself around.
Move that bowler, grab that bear, turn yourself around.
Move that bowler, grab your toes, turn yourself around.
Move that bowler, grab your toes, turn yourself around.
Demi-plié, scratch your toes, turn yourself around.
Demi-plié, scratch your toes, turn yourself around.
If I were not upon this stage, someone else I'd like to be. If I were not upon this stage, a fireman I would be. Happy all day long, and this would be my song. Turn the tap, up the ladder, put the fire out. Turn the tap, up the ladder, put the fire out.
Turn the tap, grab the ladder, terrorize the lions.
Turn the tap, grab the ladder, terrorize the lions.
Demi-plié, grab your toes, turn yourself around.
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 If I were not upon the stage, someone else I'd like to be. If I were not upon the stage, a cricketer I would be. Happy all day long, and this would be my song. Cut it here, sweep it there, I just scored a six. Cut it here, sweep it there, I just scored a six.
Cut it here, sweep it there, I just scored a six.
Cut it here, sweep it there, I just scored a six.
Cut it here, sweep the ladder, I just scored a six.
Demi-plié, grab your toes, turn yourself around.
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 Upon the stage, someone else I'd like to be. If I were not upon the stage, a traffic warden I'd be. Happy all day long, and this would be my song. You can't park here, can't park there, follow the yellow lines. You can't park here, can't park there, follow the yellow lines.
car park here, sweep it there, follow the yellow light. You car park here, sweep it there, follow the yellow light. You car park here, sweep it there, follow the yellow light. Car park here, sweep it there, follow the yellow light. You car park here, sweep it there, follow the yellow light. Car park here, sweep it there, follow the yellow light.
Come, have some port wine with me down at the old bull.